Please. Akram, why are you hiding yourself? Will you be coming tomorrow or you're going to Islamabad for Khudam Waqar-e Amal?
I'll come tomorrow.
You're coming tomorrow morning?
Yes.
Yes, please. Yes.
Assalamu alaikum. Hazur, we know that Jesus, while he was a prophet, stayed only about 3 years in Palestine. Yet we have a book, the Bible, which was revealed to him while he was in that area, only in 3 years. After that, he spent a very vast amount of his time in the eastern part of the world, Kashmir and all those places. Mm-hmm. And yet we don't have that kind of book or, you know, that much history.
It's a very interesting question and very intelligent. I think this is the first time I've heard this aspect of Jesus' life. People have been asking me questions about the disappearance of any records of his life history afterwards. But this is a very interesting question, whether the revelations continued, and if they did, why was not the record kept as an ajil?
Say even in a distorted form.
Yes. As far as the an ajil are concerned, let's first look at the nature and character of the New Testament. They are in fact narratives of what he did and how he moved about and what happened to him. Only a very small part of the so-called New Testament is in fact revelation. Otherwise, it would be taken to be a revelation not that of Jesus Christ, peace be upon him, but of his gospel, of his apostles, and of some who were not even apostles. So they have to be considered, the present form of an Ajil or the New Testament should be considered as a narrated record, like traditions of the Holy Prophet, which refer things to him, what he did and how he moved about, and or annals kept by some of his followers who saw him, and some later on from hearsay or other reports narrated certain events. But the central figure of the New Testament, the main core, which can be attributed to Jesus Christ, what he said, is very little, almost negligible as compared to the rest of the Bible story. His birth, his reputation, his disappearance, what happened to him during crucifixion, how he walked about, how he showed miracles, that is not a revelation at all. That is just a life history. So very few wahi elhamat or revelations would be found in the Anajil. And the main book of law which Jesus Christ followed and he was destined to follow was Torah and the Old Testament, mainly Torah in fact, it was Torah as law book. The rest of the Old Testament is also very similar to the New Testament in its character. So that was already there. And as far as revelations are concerned, as I have told, they were compared to the Old Testament, very few. And in fact, he didn't come to change the Torah or the older teaching. He himself admits it. I have not come to change a jot of the Bible or the old saying. of the book or of the Torah, I don't remember the exact words, but that is what he refers to, that he didn't come to change the Torah. So now, whatever little part, God must have continued to speak to him. That is very important. And even if not voluminous, we must have some record. But previously I spoke on this subject here, it was about 2 months ago. I mentioned one fact, that the personality of Jesus Christ got intermingled and intermixed with the personality of Buddha. And as a Buddha was expected to appear from about 500 to 600 years from the earlier Buddha, when Jesus Christ appeared there in exactly the same time, his teachings deeply influenced the Buddhists, and they took him to be the Buddha, which was predicted. Like Hazrat Masih Maud Alaihi Salatu Wassalam, he is called a Messiah, and his character as Messiah is so deeply accepted by us, and we know it so deeply ingrained in us, that if the records were confused later on, we would know him, or the future generation would know him as a Messiah, less a Mahdi than a Messiah. So Jesus Christ must have had two positions there. One of a Buddha, and perhaps it was he who was being predicted by the Buddha, that a new Buddha would appear. And also because of the similarities of both those teachings, things got confused, and whatever is kept under a certain Buddha in records. The records have not been lost. So it is a very interesting subject for research. Researchers must study from this point of view the book which was left, or the annals which were recorded about that Buddha which I am talking about. And there I am quite certain you will find traces of revelations to him. But again, there would be some confusion there. The confusion would be because of the present day Buddhists having turned into atheists, and they believe that Buddha himself was consummate wisdom. And it was the wisdom of Buddha, the man, which has given us light and guidance. Now, as far as the Ahmadiyya attitude is concerned, that is different, of course, and we prove our case by quoting from some earlier sources of Buddhists, that he was merely a messenger, he didn't speak from himself. But as far as the Buddhists are concerned, they look back at their own history in this perspective. So perhaps whatever has been said by Messiah after his migration to Kashmir, if it is recorded as I claim it is, as a Buddha of the time, that reference to God would be perhaps eliminated. And what you would find, a Buddha speaking from his own wisdom. But if you study that period, you will find traces which would could positively lead a researcher back to Jesus Christ, peace be upon him. Another point which is to be considered is that as far as his teachings, whatever the teachings were concerned, although they were mainly followings of they were mainly under the Torah, maybe some explanations or small deviations, but they had to be revealed in toto before he had migrated, because then his mission to the first addressees would not be complete. His first address was to those tribes of Israel who were present in Palestine. So I can't conceive him having left there without having completed his ministry to those whom he addressed in the first place. So the important parts of those revelations which were meant for the entire tribes of Israel, they had to be disclosed to him during the early period. Later on, whatever was revealed to him could have a nature of prophecies or glad tidings of events and things, or just an expression of love from God. But the most things which concerned the people whom he addressed, they must have been revealed in the first period of his life, which is known to us, having been spent in Palestine. Yes, please.
Then why is it that we don't even find even a very small,
yes,
let's say a very small minority?
I explain. That was a question which was previously asked of Ahmadis, but we couldn't give any answer, in fact. The only hope we mentioned was that Hazrat Masih Maud alayhi salatu wasalam has been categorically told by Allah that in future the earth will throw out its secrets and new evidence would be discovered concerning Messiah, which would lead ultimately to the belief that he did migrate from there and was not killed upon cross, was not murdered upon cross. These are not the words of the revelation, but revelation to this effect was given to Hazrat Masih Maud alayhi salatu wasalam, and he has written it in so many words, that Allah had told him that he would show new evidence, earth would throw up new evidence. Now, the first evidence which came to earth, positive evidence which was concerning Jesus' life after crucifixion, was from, a part of Afghanistan, Herat. But it originated from England, because one of the research scholars from Oxford, as you know, had gone there, and he came to learn of a tribe by the name of Musai. And I think most people know what happened, that during the investigations he came to learn that they called themselves Muslim Christians. And it was the head of that tribe which told him that you are completely mistaken about Jesus Christ. He did survive the crucifixion and came to us, passed through us to Kashmir, and he gave us his message, and we have got the testament which is different. Now this is also a very important point to be further investigated, that the Torah, the Bible which Jesus Christ, peace be upon him, left there, it might have got many additions. Number one, this point is to be noted, that his migration from there to Afghanistan was not a matter of a month or so. He is known to have tarried for long periods in Turkey or around Turkey somewhere, and also in Iraq. And when he appeared to St. Paul, in fact, it was not a vision. It was he himself who appeared to him later on. So when we conceive that immediately, having disappeared from there, he reappeared in Kashmir, this is a false notion altogether. He was a sick man when he left, and he had to discharge his ministry on the way. It was not just a destination of Kashmir where he was to carried on some supersonic jet. All along his journey, that was his mission. And the Israelites who had earlier migrated were found on the path to Kashmir, on the road to Kashmir. So we don't exactly know when he reappeared. And the one source from which we could judge Hindu Puranas, but their margin of error is so big that 100 years plus and minus wouldn't be surprising. So we can generally say that he took a long time traveling from Palestine to Kashmir, and Afghanistan was closest to Kashmir. Of all the journey, he had traveled the major part. So if he took, for instance, 5 years or 10 years, some new revelations must have occurred, particularly during that period of trial and stress. Now that Bible, which is kept intact by the Musa'is, that Bible, according to his statement, which is recorded by this research scholar, was not the same as the New Testament found here in Europe. It differed fundamentally with the New Testament, number one, regarding Trinity, number two, regarding the ascent of Jesus, and so on, so many factors. And it was a very clearly monotheistic message which was recorded. That Bible, according to the eyewitness, again from Oxford, was kept in scrolls. So unless we have access to that scroll, we can't really say what might have happened. And that would be a very strong piece of evidence and a very important piece of evidence in favor of the Ahmadiyya concept that he got delivered from the cross. Previously, it was just a proof from the Bible or some historical aspects. But something solid, palpable, was not in our hands. And this again is just theorization, which I'm telling you, that God must have spoken to him, he couldn't have been abandoned, and what might have been the nature of his revelations. That's just conjectures. Of course, we are certain because we have faith. But for those who do not agree with us, or those who do not have faith at all, this is just conjecture, nothing more. But the finding of a solid piece of Bible left by Jesus Christ, peace be upon him, and to note that the style is the same and the references are correct, that would be a very important advancement in Ahmadiyya literature and Ahmadiyya research on this subject. So we did attempt, in fact, to send someone. Number one, Hazrat Khalifatul Masih Salis appointed Mr. Afridi, who is nowadays in Iraq. He went to Herat, he met Abba Yahya, he discussed all that was mentioned in this book among the Dervishes, and he confirmed. So this author is not now the only source which related this incident, so it has gained more authenticity as far as Ahmadis are concerned, particularly. And when he returned to Rabwa, having visited Herat, Hazrat Khalifatul Masih Salis was not there. He had gone to some tour of Africa or England, I don't remember what. So he met me, and I questioned him and discussed the whole thing with in detail. And I was convinced that the reporting of the English author was just correct. Secondly, I asked him about attempting to get a copy of what was written. So he said the price he was asking was very high. It was beyond 100,000 rupees or so. So I was indeed shocked, because it's such a valuable thing. If for that price he could part with that part of the evidence or permit us to have photostats or other records prepared, that would have been just a gift price. But he considered it very high, and naturally he was not authorized to commit himself. So afterwards, he left a written report with the Amir Sahib Karachi, as he tells me. And I don't know what happened to that. But another attempt was made by me. Of course, I took the blessings of Khalifatul Masih Salis in this and his consent. But it didn't bear fruit. Why it didn't, Afzal Sahib can answer better. Because he was appointed to send someone to Herat and further verify, and also to try to get the scroll or the copy of the scroll. You come to the end. Answer, please.
That's true, Azul. And I intended to visit myself. And
but there was also someone else who was mentioned in this regard. You suggested that perhaps so and so could go, or he had offered. Who was that person?
Azul, I had myself intended to go.
I know that, yes. But apart from you, there was another Ahmadi who had promised he would attempt to go, and perhaps it was not, it was directly between him and us. Perhaps you
maybe,
don't know.
Maybe.
Yes, yes.
Just
I know.
Yes.
There is one.
As
I don't.
As, this was concerned, I intended to myself, but when this disturbance is concerned, unfortunately, I could not proceed.
The disturbances followed very soon.
Very soon. Very soon.
Quite right.
So, despite my wish, I could not proceed there.
I don't think it was that soon.
But that's the same time.
This is my impression, eh?
Well, at the same time, the disturbances already started at that time.
Where?
In Afghanistan.
No. I think it was after that. Quite sometimes. Six months or...
A few months when I had in mind that I would go. Yes. But it was not a long time.
Quite right.
Yes,
right.
Just but maybe a matter of 2-3 months or something
right.
like that.
So let's hope for the future and let's see.
Yes, Azul.
If Allah opens a window, naturally Allah would. I'm quite certain. Because otherwise there was no point in keeping all this record intact and suddenly spring it upon the whole world. It's a God sent to us, and Allah preserved it and ordained it. So naturally, inshallah, this would come to light one day. Yes, please.
So I had always wished and still have, if the opportunity rises and if there are any sources,
inshallah.
Certainly
I wonder whether there are some other tribes similar to that one as well.
An opening has been made.
Yeah.
I mean, that thing which was just the people poo-pooed and said, no, it's all, you know, imagination and all that, or just logic, no definite proof, no solid evidence. This was the general objection raised against us. But that barrier has been broken, and it is just the beginning. And we have seen that what was promised to Hazrat Masih Maud Salatu Wassalam has come to pass. And this is a very great thing, because if you yourself consider all that what happened, and sudden total disappearance of Jesus Christ, despite the fact that we are convinced through Bible and the Holy Quran that this must have happened, yet the opposite is also so powerful that one is overawed. One is surprised how total lack. So unless one has full faith in Ahmadiyyat as we have, naturally, a person would be shaken. But this new evidence has completely changed the whole look of the question and transformed it. I mean, it's a beginning, we know, but a very important beginning for us. Research should be made into other tribes, other unexplored corners of Afghanistan, and also in the buried records of Kashmir. Some evidence has been found different places, but small, very small evidence of references to biblical prophets, old places of Palestine and Judea and things. But that is just very little. I mean, there has to be something more. Yes, please. After him.
So I wanted to add something.
Yes, please, come on. Chanda hai.
Zur, I read in a newspaper a few months back that some new inscriptions have been found in a cave in the eastern part of Turkey. So that might put some light on the subject.
Now, were they regarding Jesus Christ, peace be upon him?
Well, I have read in the newspaper only that some inscriptions about Christianity have been found.
About Christianity?
Yes.
That's right. Yes, and what was the period of those writings? You don't know?
No, I don't know.
So you should have immediately contacted them. The author,
this is... At that time I was...
A subject you should have... You should have pounced upon this opportunity.
Yes.
Now write to them and find out more about it.
Yes.
After... Who was it now? Yes. After Mr. Bashir, I already promised him. But don't worry, I'll just permit him for one question and then we'll turn to you.
Huh? As-salamu alaykum, Hazur.
Yes, sir.
Hazur, I got a suggestion, a humble suggestion, and if time permits later, I will ask questions.
Yes, if time permits, yes.
A humble suggestion. While I was wearing a badge of sacred kalima, an English lady in our office asked me what was the badge for, and I had to explain the reason for wearing the badge and told her the meaning of the sacred kalima, and that is, there is no God but Allah. Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam is the messenger of Allah. Later, on her retirement party this week, and also on other occasions, I had to explain the meaning of the sacred kalima to many people. My suggestion in this connection is that if Hazur approves it,
an English translation should be inscribed. Yes, got it. Your Amir Sahib has heard this suggestion.
That is my
suggestion. Yes.
Hazur, these badges that were prepared were done in a great hurry. An order has been placed for 5,000 of a very superior quality.
Also, I think. The size of the kalima itself should be larger than the badge. Stress should be shifted to the size of the kalima rather than that of the badge. The most of the space of the badge is unutilized, and the kalima written is very small. So you could write kalima above, and underneath you could give the translation, but a bit in bold letters, please.
So the new one that's being prepared, the design has been approved by Vakil-e-Ala, the kalima is in the round shape and the English translation appears around it, and it's going to be something which can
but
be...
But isn't it a bit difficult to read like this, you know? Why not be straightforward? I mean, this is quite all right.
That
you know, there are certain purposes of these badges. Some are insignias. They are not meant for everybody to read. And they are not for display in the sense that everybody should be expected to read and understand what the message is. They are just there to look and appear beautiful.
Yes, sir.
And just to indicate that somebody belongs to that group. The purpose here is different. The purpose here is to convey a message very clearly. And so that everybody should be excited to ask why, what is this, and so on and so forth.
We'll have other ones also prepared.
Yes, please. No, I mean, there is no need to have these round ones. Change it to clear, it should be clearly legible.
Well, that, Uzur, will be in addition to these, because this order has been placed.
Already been.
And they've done the metal work. It's only the...
Let's first see them, then we'll decide.
Yes, sir. I think Uzur will like them, because they're...
Like I will. Different. Yeah, that I don't know. Because I don't doubt. Yes. Which question? Which question? You already said what you said. Pardon? All right, please go ahead.
After the Meccans surrendered and peace was restored, the Holy Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam returned to Medina. Although he visited Mecca several times, but Medina became his permanent home. So when he died, he was buried there. As the Holy Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam never did anything without purpose, and there was hikmat in all his actions, I would like to request Hazur to please enlighten us in this regard as to what might have led the Holy Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam to prefer Medina over Mecca for abode.
That Hazrat sallallahu alaihi wasallam himself explained during that incident when he was distributing the war spoils after he returned from Hunain and some other expeditions. You remember that somebody objected from among the Medinites. There was in fact a great hypocrite who had joined Islamic forces, but who had not had no belief in Islam whatsoever. He was a man of very suspicious character too. Now perhaps he had joined the Islamic forces in the hope of sharing the booty. When Hazrat sallallahu alaihi wasallam distributed the spoils of war, he didn't give anything to the Medinites, to the Ansar, but distributed the entire spoils among the people of Mecca. Now, this man could not tolerate, because the whole purpose of his exercise was lost. So he objected. And the words he used were that it is our swords which are dripping blood. That is the swords of Ansar. And you have distributed all these spoils to the Meccans who just accepted Islam, and you know right. So Aunt Salam addressed the gathering. We got asked everybody to be present, and afterwards he spoke those historic words where he said, you could have said this, you could have said that, you could have said that. And he admitted that yes, you Medina people are very dear to me. They have done this and that and that. And you could have added that too. That when nobody looked after you, when you were turned out from your houses, it was the Medina people who offered their homes. When you were without shelter, it was the Medina people who offered shelter. And he went on building this to a great pathetic height. He said, why not add all this? And afterwards, when I distributed all this, you could have said, when the time of distribution of things, I mean, material wealth was, came, what sort of profit we have? He distributed everything to the Meccans and gave Medina people nothing. But you could have looked at it from a different angle altogether and could have seen that when the time came for the final decision, where the Prophet would live, he chose Medina and not Mecca. He gave the material wealth to the Meccans and the spiritual wealth, everything that Islam came, I mean, the very embodiment of Islam, he gave that himself to the Medina people. Now, when Anas Salam was delivering this lecture, this speech, the whole of the Ansar were crying like anything, like children, and as if they were being slaughtered. they suffered so much, and they asked Rasulullah Sallam to stop. And he said, no, let me continue. And they said, this wanton man, he's ignorant, he has said something, and why should we all suffer for this? So Anwar Sahib replied that sometimes it so happens that one stupid man from among the people brings misery to the whole people. And because someone from among you has said such things about the Holy Prophet, so you have to now suffer the fate. And having declared that he had decided to go himself to Medina, so to console the Meccans, he gave the worldly material things and returned himself to Medina to reward them. That was the purpose, in fact, of his going back to Medina. Then he said, but this thing, what he has said, has annoyed God, and he has displeased God, and he has declared a punishment for you, that there would be no future caliph or king from the Medinites. It will always be from the Meccans. And this is exactly what happened. Yes, please, after him. Yes.
Assalamu alaikum. I'd like to, in Urdu question, please.
Yes, please, yes.
वो पहले बात हो रही थी हज़रत ईसा अलैहिस्सलाम पर. बाइबल में एक लाइन है अरमतिया यूसुफ के मुतलक, वो बड़ी इम्पोर्टेंट है, आप उस पर
क्या?
जैसे कि वो लाश ले गया परत उससे मांगी,
उसका
जिक्र भी नहीं है, कहीं नहीं मिलता.
क्या
कि वो उसको लाश को ले गया अपनी जगह पर, उसी ने एस्केप कराई. तो मेरे कहने का मतलब है कि उसका तो सबसे बड़ा पार्ट उसी का ही है पूरी बाइबल में.
यूसुफ अरमतिया
जी,
हाँ जी.
तो
सवाल क्या है?
सवाल तो उसके साथ ही तलग रहा था जो पहला क्वेश्चन ही था, कि उसके भी अगर इंक्वायरी की जाए तो अरमतिया का भी पता चलना चाहिए कि
वो तो मालूम है, मारूफ है. यूसुफ अरमतिया एक ऐसा शख्स था जिसके जो हजरत मसीह के पर ईमान लाता था, और उसके पायलट से बड़े गहरे ताल्लुकात थे
जी.
तो चूंकि वो जाहरी तौर पर ईमान नहीं लाया हुआ था, इसलिए यानी खुलम खुला, इसलिए उसको इस्तेमाल किया हवारियों ने. और दूसरे हवारियों के लिए ये मुमकिन नहीं था कि वो झूठ बोलें या ऐसी चलाकी करें कि ये झूठ के करीब करीब पहुंच जाए. लेकिन यूसुफ अरमतिया तो चूंकि फॉर्मल मोमिन नहीं था, जहाँ तक मुझे याद है यही उसकी एग्जैक्ट पोजिशन है, इस वास्ते यूसुफ अरमतिया गया और पिलातुस से कहा कि अब हमें लाश दे दी जाए, और उसने उसके जवाब में कहा ऑलरेडी डेड, अब इतनी जल्दी मर गया? उन्होंने कहा हाँ, वो तो ही गेव अप द गोस्ट एंड दिस एंड दैट, और उनसे लाश मांग ली. और मालूम यह होता है कि यूसुफ को भी, यूसुफ ने ज़ाहरी तौर पर खाना पूरी की है पायलट के सामने, ताकि वो मजबूर ना हो जाए इनकार करने पर. वरना जिस तरह आप अंदाज़ा होता है, पायलट खुद शामिल था इस बात में. हज़रत मसीह मौऊद अलैहिस्सलाम हैज़ मेंशन्ड दिस इन सम ऑफ हिज बुक्स, दैट द वे थिंग्स वर ऑर्गेनाइज्ड, द डेट वाज फिक्स्ड, द टाइम वाज एस्टिमेटेड टू बी इन द लेटर पार्ट ऑफ द डे. ऑल दीज फैक्टर्स इंडिकेट that Pilate wanted Jesus Christ to be saved, and there was something going underneath, you know, under the surface, and Yusuf Amitya played a very important role in this. He was perhaps the go-between, and it was decided that Pilate would work through him, or he would work, disciples would work through him. So everything seems to be highly organized and pre-arranged.
हज़ूर मेरा मतलब था कि वो उसकी तो वो अपनी private जगह पर ले गया.
नहीं नहीं
जी,
वहाँ से remove करके उनको ले गए हैं गार में, जहाँ उनको रखा गया है, और
लेकिन वो उसकी अपनी प्राइवेट प्रॉपर्टी थी ना,
फिर क्या हो गया?
जिसमें कि मैंने कहा वो लेडीज तो नहीं आ सकती ना उसकी कब्र पर देखने के लिए कि वो पत्थर हटाइए, क्योंकि प्राइवेट जगह पर तो दूसरे
नहीं, नहीं आप इट वाज नॉट द ब्रिटिश गवर्नमेंट और एनी मॉडर्न डेवलप्ड कंट्री लाइक दिस कंट्री वे यू कांट ट्रेसपास इवन ए स्टेप इनटू समबडी एल्सस प्रॉपर्टी. Even private properties like we have in Pakistan, everybody walks through and across and day and night. In our place, Ahmednagar, I have a garden, we have fences around, and yet people walk through it like it's their own and pick up fruit and things and steal things as they please. This is the common practice in the modern world in Pakistan. But, well, Pakistan perhaps doesn't belong to the modern age. The way they are behaving towards Ahmadiyya, that's what I mean. But anyway, normally they should belong to this age. So why not 2000 years ago? Yes, please, Shamim's brother?
Naeem's brother.
Naeem's brother, I'm sorry, yes, Naeem's brother. You are Shamim?
Yes.
Yes.
this question is not as serious as the last one, but it originated from my best half. She had asked me to ask you this question.
You have more than one wife? One wife? You have more than one wife?
No, sir.
So, because normally one wife is referred to as better half. So when you said best half, I thought perhaps there were three or four wives.
It's funny that you raised this question, sir. Probably my question is also
please.
In that context, really. She had asked this question, requested me to ask you this question, but long time ago, but she had forgotten about it and she never asked me back what you did, whether I asked it or not. But all of a sudden, she's got interested again. And
Suddenly. Yes.
And she said, could you ask Hazur that... what are the circumstances under which a person is entitled to perform nikah?
I'm surprised. I mean, I can't understand this question at all. Circumstances under which one is entitled to perform nikah?
Nikah ceremony. I mean,
when there is a nikah to be performed, then it is performed. I can't follow, really. I have totally missed the point. If you could explain further.
I think I'd better give you some background to it.
Yes, please.
It's been noticed that in certain circumstances people ignore the Jamaat and center or Imam and go and get their nikah performed somewhere else. That's the background of it.
No, but there is no harm if it is all in order. If the law of Sharia is not broken, it is not essential in Islam that a certain priesthood should perform the nikah. Now, if there is some hanky-panky or some breaking of law, if that nikah is performed by the Imam, it would still remain censurable. So one should be straightforward about these things. If a nikah has come to the notice of your wife, which she thinks is not legal, which is not according to the traditions of, well, not traditions, according to the clear-cut rules of Islam, she should point out what is the defect. And if there is a defect, whether it is performed by the Imam or performed by Mr. ABC, I would definitely put the person to task. But not through scandals, please.
I think the main aspect of nikah ceremony or importance of nikah ceremony is the announcement within the community that the nikah has been performed.
No, announcement before a few people together. No hiding should be done. If you think some fundamental aspect of the rights of nikah as dictated by Islam have been omitted intentionally or inadvertently, whatever may be, You better write to me. I mean, this is not forum, not a forum for complaining against a certain person.
No, I'm not. That's just.
You are referring to the same, but not admitting it. Please sit
probably
down.
Probably the same background.
Please sit down. Yes.
Thank you.
Please, Rashid Sahib.
So I have a little suggestion, if you allow me to say it, sir. I was reading Holy Quran today, and I came to the Surah Al-Imran. And in that, Allah Ta'ala has said, وَمَنْ يَبْتَغِ غَيْرَ إِسْلَامٍ
غَيْرَ الْإِسْلَامِ دِينًا فَلَنْ يُقْبَلَ مِنْهُ
دِينًا فَلَنْ يُقْبَلَ مِنْهُ
يُقْبَلَ مِنْهُ
فِي الْآخِرَةِ مِنَ الْخَاسِرِينَ
Yes.
One or two ideas.
I have already spoken on this subject more than once. Please.
Yeah, one or two ideas came to me, sir, about this when I read that, to propagate Islam, especially in this country, and American people as well. That was, sir, I mean, in 1989, inshallah ta'ala, we are having our 100th year of Jubilee. I wonder, sir, if it's possible to have a book containing few chapters regarding this, giving the full introduction of the Holy Quran. And one chapter explaining what Islam is, one small chapter about 100 questions on Islam put by these leading people.
How many questions?
About 100 questions, because it's 100 years.
One small chapter about 100 questions.
Well, I'm just requesting.
Very interesting,
sir.
Yes, yes.
About 100 hadiths will do same time, sir.
I see.
100 malfuzat, if possible.
Yes.
And then some spiritual. You know,
altogether, how many pages? 100 pages?
No, I'm just requesting, sir. I mean, being a special Jubilee year for us, if it's a proper book done on the serious set of book with questions and all these details, and we can easily, I mean, give it to our friends so that they can really get good and thorough introduction.
Such a huge book would not be delivered easily, that I assure you.
Well, that
the
was
volume of this book, which you are suggesting, would swell to 5,000 pages or so.
Well, in that case, I mean, you have, after all, the final say. You can cut it down.
No, I tell you one thing. But right from the start of this decision. Right from the commencement, a committee was appointed to plan the entire Jubilee, all the aspects for the entire world, what literature should be produced, and where, in what quantity, what should be the subject matter, all other things to be displayed and done, performed, the countries to be won. New countries, new jamaats to be made, and so on and so forth. And Chaudhry Hamidullah Sahib was the secretary of that planning commission. And Sheikh Muhammad Ahmad Sahib was the president of that planning commission, and I also happened to be a member out of many. And we worked for many years on this and spent hours upon hours. One day, sometimes continuously for 2-3 days and so on. So all these reports were submitted to Hazrat Khalifatul Masih Salih, and they were approved mostly or modified, and then the final thing was decided and was ultimately being executed, put into practice. And because I have got that, the entire background in my mind, I remember, because I was involved personally almost in every task. So already the work is being done about literature. Everything has been decided already. And the literature part is also being looked into, and it's being produced, but not like this 100, you know, in every respect and everything. This is just a childish approach.
All right, sir. Thank you very much. May I ask a question now, sir?
It's enough, isn't it? Yes. For the time being, I'll give you some more time, please. Yes.
Assalamu alaikum, Huzur. I happened to see Dawn paper, which is published from Karachi, one Muslim scholar article talking about Zoroaster of Persia or Iran.
Huh?
Zoroaster. Zoroaster.
Zoroaster. Zoroaster. Yes, correct. Huh.
And Confucius from China, the Sri Buddha of India, were appeared in East prophets. It's actually Ahmadiyya beliefs and our conception. Whenever we talk about this view, they are always opposing. So recently, they also started writing such an articles. Just the information I got it. That's all.
Well, I have to see the article first before I answer your question. What's it all about? And only then I would be able to decide the purpose, the objective of that article. Correct. You have read and I have not read. Okay. That's the problem.
Basically,
yes. Yes, yes.
Thank you.
Thank you. Yes? After him. Uh-huh, yes?
Assalamu alaikum.
Wa alaikum.
While you were on the subject of Jesus, the promised Messiah has written in the Jesus in India that two kind of coin has been found in his times, in which one was commemorated and honored Jesus, and yes, the other was his own figure on it. And where are those coins? Because if I be mentioned,
that is a very important question you have raised. I think this has to be investigated. Somebody should be appointed in Qadian to particularly trace these coins, because we don't know for certain. The way they are mentioned, they just speak of a report about the coins, but no positive place is mentioned where they are kept, preserved and so on. So it's better for Qadian to further investigate it.
Thank you, sir.
Yes, thank you. Yes, please.
After this trouble in Pakistan against us, we have been reading in the newspaper all the time from the other side what are our beliefs, and they are wrong, and this, that. Why we have not been able to tell ourselves our belief first, and then they should...
I mean, we have not been able to publish in the newspapers,
and
because we don't publish them.
Don't we raise this question? Not even they publish the National Assembly's deliberations when they declare a non-Muslim in Pakistan.
You have been trying to press them, convince them that they should publish those proceedings. They have refused adamantly.
It looks funny that they tell us what our beliefs are.
Of course it is. It is. That's correct. You're so right. But this is why I stress on the personal preaching and participation of every MD in protest against this attitude, and to react so strongly that their efforts are frustrated and more people know about the truth of Ahmadiyyat. So this is what is happening in so many places, and with good results. So the answer to this is that you should also redouble your efforts and tell every friend, everyone concerned, or even find out how to expand your circle of acquaintance and give them that knowledge, whether you're asked or not. Go on telling them. Yes. Yes, please. Your introduction first, Assam.
In the Bible.
Your introduction, please.
Shahnawaz Rashid.
Shahnawaz Rashid. Your father's?
Abdul Rashid.
Hyderabadi Sahib. Ah, right. Now, please.
In the Bible, there's a chapter called the Transfiguration. And it says that Jesus went up on a mountain, and Moses and Elijah were on the mountain.
where he was put on trial by Satan?
No.
That is the reference or different reference?
No.
Which reference is he giving? You remember?
Explain further. Jesus went up on a mountain and he saw Moses and Elijah on the mountain.
I don't remember ever having read it. So you better first give me the definite reference. Then I'll be able to answer you.
Mark chapter 13, I think.
So find out if it's here. Is it here? Well, tomorrow you can come and give the reference. I'll go through that and find out what you have, what is perplexing you.
Okay.
Tell me first, after having said this, build your question, and then when I see into it, I'll be able to answer.
That Jesus was greater than Moses and Elijah.
I don't remember having read it anywhere in the Bible, any book whatsoever.
I don't get that.
Huh?
But when he went to the mountain at the time of departure, and at that time...
Which departure?
Jesus' departure. It's written that he ascended to heaven.
No, he's not referring to that.
No.
You are inventing a new thing altogether.
The disciples saw some people wearing white clothes.
Yes, so.
White
clothes are the common factor so far.
And when he ascended to heaven, at that time, it is written in the Bible.
I'm surprised, absolutely surprised, really. Unless I read it, I don't know how I missed it, but unless I read it and refresh my knowledge of the Bible, I won't be able to answer this question. So give the definite reference, and you better to provide it tomorrow to me. Right?
Yes.
Give the reference.
It's Mark chapter 12 or 13.
I 12 to 13?
Yeah.
Thank you so much for pointing out, because that's in addition to my knowledge that this is also being claimed. Yes. Yes. नहीं फिर कल सही ठीक है सर आई मीन टुमारो लेट ओनली 5 मिनट्स लेफ्ट फॉर मी टू डिपार्ट ओनली 5 मिनट्स फॉर मी टू गो सो बेटर पोस्टपोन इट टिल टुमारो इंशाल्लाह एनी अदर क्वेश्चन यस दिस इज रॉन्ग गो बैक एंड पुट इट बैक ऑन द हेड ऑफ द जेंटलमैन यू हैव stolen it from. Yes, please.
My question is about language.
About what?
Language.
Yes.
In this
world, which language? Any language.
Yes. In this world, so many prophets came and they taught their own language.
Mm-hmm.
And died and gone back. And we are in this world, different people are speaking our own languages, in our own language. Now the thing is this, the day of judgment, what language we will speak in front of God? Because if I speak Urdu, I'm not, as you see, I am not speaking well English.
Yes, I understand the point.
Yes.
This question is now already being debated by the parapsychologists. They claim that they are the only people capable of understanding the language of the visitors from space and vice versa. Because when they convey things to their counterpart, without the agency of any known means to science, without the agency of air or electromagnetic waves and things, they do it not in words, but in pictures. They think of something, and that thing is conveyed If they want to do something, that person again wants to do something. So they have advanced this theory that the only way of communication between various terrestrial bodies can be without a language. Now this is a very interesting subject, and also it has been discussed in a book, Life After Life. Many a person who returned to this life while he was clinically declared dead, he recounted his experience, and something which is common in many experiences is this, that they understood without words, and they saw without seeing, like this, and they saw right across the rooms, walls and curtains, and it was neither strange nor unusual to them during that experience. And they were positive that they understood, but not through the light of day. And they saw things and visualized not through the light of day, nor through the waves, the sound waves, but it was just in knowledge. So that reminds one of experiences of dreams. There too, you have the same thing. Even those who have no knowledge of Arabic, they sometimes converse with some Sahabi or some other Arabian people or some other people in this world too, whose languages are different. And don't find it difficult at all. When they get up, they remember only the meaning. Although some sort of language was used by them, but that was just in fact an impression. What was important was the meaning conveyed and preserved in their memory. And that was definitely not through the language they think it reached them, because they don't know that language at all. So that is one possibility, of course, of some media through which God would convey the impressions and senses. Your impressions and your knowledge and senses are exactly the same as anywhere else in your situation who speaks a different language. They are the important things. They transmit them, first transform them into language and then transmit. For instance, if you want to find a positive proof of this, you can speak to a dumb person. He does not know any language, does he? A dumb person, mute and dumb, he has no language, yet he conveys meanings in such detail that everybody is surprised. Sometimes some intelligent mute and dumb people can convey the whole speeches, and neither they were conveyed to them through words, nor they know any words, and yet an exchange of experience is effected. For instance, there was a gentleman, Mr. Abdul Aziz, we called him Gunga. He, as a child, stayed with Hazrat Mirza Bashir Ahmad Sahib Razi Allah Ta'ala Anho, and he was also known as Mian Bashir Ahmad Sahib's Gunga, you know, because he was, you know, a very, very intelligent person and liked popular with everybody, and Hazrat Mian Bashir Ahmad Sahib was so kind to him. So because of this kindness to him, he was called Hazrat Mian Bashir Ahmad Sahib's Gunga. Now this Gunga, unfortunately, was not very particular about truth. You know, he would invent things and freely speak of things which he had imagined and things. And he wouldn't miss a prayer or a khutbah but he was so fond of telling others what Hazrat Khalifatul Masih had said, that even if he had not visited the mosque, he would immediately learn from someone what he had said, would understand, and whoever asked him whether he had been to the khutbah, he said, yes, I can tell you. And he would tell in detail everything. While those who understood the language, perhaps they could not do it better than he did. How? No words are used, no language. So that must be some. There must be something else which would be used, something else which would be used in the hereafter to transmit things from one to the other. Right? Please. Yes. I think some interesting lecture has been recollected by you now. Huh? Tell us about it.
I remember once there was a jalsa in Qadian, in Iman Khana, and there was speeches in different languages. And Abdulaziz Gunga was also given a chance to give a lecture on Sadaqat of Masih Islam. And he delivered for about 10 or 15 minutes, and then that was the last person to speak.
Yes. And he has his own theories about the beginning of life and the creation of man and everything. And he described these things so beautifully. He wouldn't miss the smallest point. For instance, his creation of his theory about the creation of man. So he used to tell us that Allah created everything below, and the man in the heaven, which that he had heard, of course, from some religious people. As people thought in the older days, that Adam was created in heaven and the earth was a different place. So he said, he was very fond of tea, that you should bear in mind. So he said, Allah created everything, and then he created man. But when the man was created, he would not come to gain consciousness. The angels shook the man up and beat him and did this and that, but he just wouldn't gain consciousness. He wouldn't open his eyes. So he used to say, when Allah designed how Allah thought, you know, he was to do like this. Allah did this, thinking, what should I do? So he said, yes, I have got it. And he told the angels to bring tea. So they prepared tea. And when the smell entered the nostrils, you know, then he began to, you know, move about. And when the first cup touched the lip, immediately he was all awake. He said, yes, please more, you know. So one problem solved. But then Allah wanted him to leave the heaven and go to the earth below. So they opened the window, he saw and said, no, nothing doing, I don't like it there. So they tried to convince him, everybody was sent one after the other, higher angels, and still belonged to the hierarchy and so on. Nothing doing. He would simply refuse. Then God, again, you know, knocked his head like this and said, yes, I'm... This is how he described things. He said, well, I've got it. He said, mint some money. So angels started minting money. He said, put them in sacks and bags. And now starting throwing them from heaven to the earth. And when the Adam heard the jingling of the money, he could no longer resist. He just dived down. And there he was. Secondly, he had a theory that Adam had his children there. I mean, quite a few of them were already there. So when they heard, they saw their father disappear like this, they also rushed behind him. And those who fell, you know, in a way that the eyes were hit, they became blind. Those who fell on the side of the ears, their ears became, you know, useless, and they became deaf, and so on and so forth. That was his explanation of disease, the original disease. But and he had built, I mean, I'm just telling you, specimens. He had a complete picture of the entire concept of the creation of universe and things, and that was without words. All right, assalamu alaikum.